Morning and praise the Lord.
Amen.
I was fearing what he was going to say about me, and I'm glad he did not go so far. It's a joy and delight to be here and to be invited to participate in this consultation, but it is hard to come after the morning speakers. I feel that I will not fit their shoes, but I will try to make my own shoe. I want to acknowledge colleagues who are here, colleagues that I work with at St. Paul's University. I acknowledge the presence of bishops who have come to be with us. Let me say I'm very impressed. Sometimes we have conferences and you don't see, you may see one if you're lucky. But this is a special conference, so thank you very much, the organizers, because you've made our university to be visited by more than one bishop at a time. It's a very good gesture. Let me also say that I come to you as a believer, as one who has walked the journey of gender equality, as one who has struggled within the church to say that men and women are created in the image and likeness of God. And not being just to both genders is not right in the sight of God. And I want to thank God that although we are still in the journey, we have just begun. I do hope that the church will be transformed so that the world can see, so that the church can be leader in this area of gender equality. I may not be speaking from a very wide context. I will be speaking basically from the context I know best, and that is the context of Africa, but even so, speaking about Kenya. So some of my imagery and expressions will be local, but I'm sure you can identify with them as from your own contexts. I'll jump the abstract and jump the objective, and then just ask you to look at the imagery that is being projected now. And I do hope that that imagery will guide us as we think through the whole topic of sexual violence and abuse, or sexual harassment and abuse. In the third image, that image, I'm sure is still very live to many of the Kenyans, and you hear in the radio a voice like Nilikuja, Nikalala, Kanichapa na Miwa. No, it's a very common you hear in the local dailies. The other image. Now I can see the tempers are going high in the last image. I will then start now looking at just some of the statistics when it comes to issues of sexual harassment or gender-based violence or sexual abuse. And this is just picking at random the statistics. Worldwide, an estimated 40 to 70% of homicides of women are committed by intimate partners. A commonly accepted estimate is that one in every three women has been beaten, coerced into sex, or otherwise abused in her lifetime. So if three women stood in this building, one of them has gone through that. The latest poll about what men hate in women is 45% said they were so annoyed by indecent dressing by women. And last night, if you watched any news, there's a big debate on whether women, girls, can wear miniskirts. One of the men was interviewed last night said, if I see a girl in a skirt, I'll be attracted to her, to her legs. When we think of gender-based violence or sexual violence, what we are saying is that 83% of women and girls in Kenya report one or more episodes of physical abuse in childhood. 46% report one or more episodes of sexual abuse in childhood, and 25% of girls report losing their virginity by force. That is a UN research. Gender-based violence is violence that is directed at an individual based on her or his specific gender and role in society. While it can affect both males and females, gender-based violence affects women and girls disproportionately. A colleague used to say that in a building like this, if he said, can the men remove their shirts and show us an injury inflicted upon them by a woman, we may find none. But if women were told, remove your blouses and show us an injury inflicted upon you by a male, you'll definitely find some even in this building. So it is violence that establishes or reinforces gender hierarchies and perpetuates gender inequalities. According to Freedom, gender-based violence attacks the fundamental human rights of adults and children alike. Gender-based violence is abuse that is meted on an individual by virtue of their gender, just said that. Sometimes it is domestic violence, and it occurs when a family member, partner or ex-partner attempts to physically, sexually, economically or psychologically dominate another. Domestic violence is perpetrated by and on men and women and occurs in the same sex and opposite sex relations. It takes many forms, including physical violence, sexual abuse, emotional abuse, intimidation, economic deprivation, or threats of violence. Sexual violence, which is what I'm going to be talking to this morning, has many definitions, but I just take a few. Sexual violence includes and is not limited to harassment, rape, being forced to perform strange sexual acts, denial of sex, criticizing sexual performance, being forced to see others having sex, rape as a weapon in war, etc. Although men also suffer from sexual violence, as we are going to see, statistics show that women suffer more than the men, or women suffer more from the device. So sexual violence knows no socio-economic boundaries. Rich women, poor women, black women, white women, educated women, illiterate women, religious women, beautiful, ugly, all women are potential targets of violence. And all women are at some degree at a risk. I want us, therefore, to hear two episodes that will be read to us. And from those episodes, then we can continue. The first one is a story from the Daily Nation, which was February this year, and also it appeared this month in our local dailies.
I arrived home drunk, and my wife opened the door for me. I gave her 250 shillings to buy food for the children, and then retired to bed. She joined me in bed and did not undress, saying that she be left alone. I pretended to sleep, but then decided to make physical contact with her. This led her to jump out of bed. She picked a panga and descended on me, slashing my head. All the while, I was screaming and she ran out of the room and locked the door from the outside. I managed to break the window and ran to my late brother's house, where his wife called for help and neighbors came to the rescue. I must have passed out because when I came to, I was in hospital and I had stitches all over my face, neck and shoulders. We have had our differences, but I did not expect it came up to this. Mr. Kibuta, 40 years of age, passed out after he bled profusely on Monday night. He was placed at intensive care at the Nyeri Provincial General Hospital, where his neighbors took him on Tuesday morning. On Friday, the wife was missing from their home in Mehote village in Mukurani district, Nyeri County, prompting police to begin a search for her whereabouts. 5 months later, this story is repeated in the Daily Nation, and this time the wife of Mr. Kibuta, her name is Julia Wairimu, 29 years, but she does not speak. She could not be reached for any comments. Her former husband says that his wife knows only too well that he was the final decision maker in their home. He also states that his 29-year-old wife, Julia Wairimu, never threatened or attempted to hit him since she feared him. When I talked, she kept quiet. She kept quiet and did all I say without asking questions. Finally, he disclosed that on the fateful night, he had given his wife 250 shillings to buy food and collect an extra 1,000 from his father the next morning to buy shoes for their firstborn daughter.
Thank you. So that is incident one. And we can ask ourselves some questions because it is a local story. Were Julia and Simon members of a church? Was Julia a regular churchgoer? Was Julia probably a member of the Mothers Union, and I speak from the tradition I belong to, or the Women's Guild at the traditions? Did she ever share about her marital problems with fellow women in the church? How do we react when a woman discloses that she's being violated by her husband? Probably, Julia did share with her sisters in church about her miserable life, and probably she got some responses. We all suffer, my dear. Don't think you are the only one. As women, we have to persevere. That is our fate. You have to trust and obey. Be obedient, since the man is the head of the house. You depend on him since you married him. Make the best of it. Try to do your best. Cook for him. Care for him. Let him feel that he is the boss, that he is in control. Story number two.
Samuel 13, verse 1 till 22. In the course of time, Amnon, son of David, fell in love with Tamar, the beautiful sister of Absalom, son of David. Amnon became so obsessed with his sister Tamar that he made himself ill. She was a virgin, and it seemed impossible for him to do anything to her. Now Amnon had an advisor named Jonadab, son of Shimeah, David's brother. Jonadab was a very shrewd man. He asked Amnon, "Why do you, the king's son, look so haggard morning after morning? Won't you tell me?" Amnon said to him, "I'm in love with Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister." "Go to bed and pretend to be ill," Jonadab said. "When your father comes to you to see you, say to him, 'I would like my sister Tamar to come and give me something to eat. Let her prepare the food in my sight so I may watch her and then eat it from her hand.'" So Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill. When the king came to see him, Amnon said to him, "I would like my sister Tamar to come and make some special bread in my sight, so I may eat from her hand." David sent word to Tamar at the palace, Go to the house of your brother Amnon and prepare some food for him. So Tamar went to the house of her brother Amnon, who was lying down. She took some dough, kneaded it, made the bread in his sight, and baked it. Then she took the pan and served him the bread. But he refused to eat. Send everyone out of here, Amnon said. So everyone left him. Then Amnon said to Tamar, bring the food here into my bedroom so I may eat from your hand. And Tamar took the bread she had prepared and brought it to her brother Amnon in his bedroom. But when she took it to him to eat, he grabbed her and said, come to bed with me, my sister. No, my brother, she said to him, don't force me. Such a thing should not be done in Israel. Don't do this wicked thing. What about me? Where could I get rid of my disgrace? And what about you? You would be like one of the wicked fools in Israel. Please speak to the king. He will not keep me from being married to you. But he refused to listen to her. And since he was stronger than she, he raped her. Then Amnon hated her with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he had loved her. Amnon said to her, get up and get out. No, she said to him, sending me away would be a greater wrong than what you have already done to me. But he refused to listen to her. He called his personal servant and said, get this woman out of my sight and bolt the door after her. So his servant put her out and bolted the door after her. She was wearing an ornate robe, for this was the kind of garment the virgin daughters of the king wore. Tamar put ashes on her head and tore the ornate robe she was wearing. She put her hands on her head and went away, weeping aloud as she went. Her brother Absalom said to her, has that Amnon, your brother, been with you? Be quiet for now, my sister. He's your brother. Don't take this thing to heart. And Tamar lived in her brother Absalom's house, a desolate woman. When King David heard all this, he was furious. And Absalom never said a word to Amnon, either good or bad. He hated Amnon because he had disgraced his sister Tamar.
For those who go to some of the churches, we would finish that reading by saying, and this is the word of as the story was being read, I could hear deep sighs. And I wonder whether that portion of scripture is ever read and people preach out of it. I'm not going to preach out of it, but just to encourage that, read it and find out how many men it took to rape Tamar. Her brother, her father, servant. How many men does it take to sexually abuse women in our churches? In the Hebrew Bible, Tamar is a model for victimized victim, a position that abused women today experience. Amnon rapes Tamar, discards her, and refuses to marry her. The community responds by expelling her as a piece of ruined property, and the biblical narratives forget her. Let's look at some of the similarities between these two stories. One, it's clear that from both of them, the women are silenced. All power to act or even speak is taken away from Tamar, for example. Julia Wairimu's story is not hard. Simon says, or Kagitu says, when I talked, she kept quiet. Of course, Paul tells women to keep quiet, and I thank the speaker earlier for raising that and putting it in context. Sexual violence against women is silenced or interpreted in the background of power relations between men, as in 2 Samuel, or property issues. King David did not mourn because of Tamar, but he wept for the rapist and the rapist's brother. So he was worried about his two sons. Even Simon Kiguta, I will keep my children. I don't care about the other one. Sexual violence is often domestic violence. Tamar was sexually assaulted, not by a stranger, but by someone she knew. Simon Kiguta is allegedly slashed by his wife, while Julia Wairimu is allegedly violated by her husband. At least she was denied the right to speak. She was sexually abused and denied the right to economic empowerment, all within the house, 250 shillings to go and buy food. Because sexual violence is often committed in safe spaces, in the homes, in the bedrooms, in offices, in the vestry. I didn't want to write that one down. It is deemed to be private, and thus it is not talked about. The case of Simon Kiguta is an exception because violence against men is an exception. It is going against power hierarchy. And thus, it was hot news in Kenya in February, and you could see maendeleo ya wanaume coming out to save the man because a woman had done it. Because sexual abuse or sexual violence is considered to be a private matter, it is surrounded by shame, blame, embarrassment, stigma, and fear of retribution. What are the roots of sexual violence? The roots of sexual violence against women lie in historically unequal power relations between men and women and pervasive discrimination against women in both the public and the private spheres. Patriarchal disparities of power, discriminatory cultural norms, and economic inequalities serve to deny women's human rights and perpetuate violence. Sexual violence is one of the key means through which male control over women's agency and sexuality is maintained, according to the UN Declaration. But the reality is that the roots of sexual violence lie within patriarchy. And patriarchy, as it's defined, is the rule of the father. It refers to a system of legal, socio-economic, and political relations that has existed for centuries and which reinforces the idea of the male as the head over the persons in the household. In most African cultures, man's property included his wives and children. In contemporary sense, this domination extends to include any other marginalized group in society. In all these cases, it involves the oppressive exercise of power by fathers, husbands, lovers, employers, or governments. It is also rooted in our own cultures. And Musimbi Kanyoro has said this about culture in defining, she says, is a particular people. A particular people have its own culture. It is distant, it is a distinct way of living, loving, eating, playing, and worshiping. Culture may refer to the musical and visual arts, modern influences on life, and acquired tradition or regulations that bind a community together. Culture, she argues, can be a double-edged sword. It can form community identity, and it can also be used to set apart, oppress those whom culture defines as the other. Participation in culture is so natural and so ubiquitous that most people take culture for granted. So using this definition, we can say that no one exists outside one or another culture. Culture is a major framework of meaning which guides how relationships are formulated and lived. Culture is different for different people, groups, and times. Culture does not always serve the needs and interests of all its members. Culture can be used to sanction the suppression of certain members of society. Culture is not natural, but a social product. Culture is not static, but dynamic, or it changes. When culture is used against women's empowerment, it is normally some form of traditional culture, which in Africa was largely patriarchal. African women theologians, that is the circle, have endeavored to deal with this issue of gender emanating from culture. They offer what we call an objective critique of African culture so that the things that were empowering in the culture are taken on board, but those that were disempowering are critiqued and challenged. Within culture, we do find sayings that are negative. They can be compared with the sayings of the church fathers that we heard this morning. Just to mention a few, I didn't put the tribes where they come from because of the heated debates of ethnicity in this country. One tribe says women have no mouths, so what do they have? Another tribe says women never reign. We see that. Another tribe says what the devil does in a year, an old woman does in an hour. In another culture, they say if you give your heart to a woman, she will kill you. Another one says a man's yes is yes, a woman's yes is often no. It is in that context, therefore, that sexual violence takes place. And as Mimi said in the morning, it is rooted in what we believe about the other. So if you believe, for example, that women never reign, you will never treat them as equal leaders. If you believe that a man's yes is yes, a woman's yes is often no, even if she screams when she's being violated, nobody will take note of it. In fact, sometimes in court in the past, they used to ask, did you scream? And did you scream when you were being violated? Sexual violence is rooted in unequal power relations between men and women, or hierarchical relations. Men are placed at the top on the pyramid of human relations and are systematically encouraged to view power as dominating and controlling. Sexual violence is rooted in the patriarchal construction of power, where power is seen as dominant and controlling. It wields its ugly hands against those who are vulnerable and powerless. A system that positions men over women, or some men over men, and instills a sense of entitlement and privilege in men. Patriarchy also institutionalized the social, cultural, and legal context that permit gender violence or sexual violence. Violence against women, therefore, is grounded in power imbalances between men and women, and is caused and perpetuated by factors different than violence against men. As such, it must be analyzed and addressed differently. I'm being harassed here. How many times has the church has implicitly promoted sexual violence by preaching hierarchy in relationships between men and women? The church has taught a patriarchal theology which supports forms of authority which can and are misused. The church has interpreted the scriptures to justify sexual violence. The church has held traditions and practices that have justified sexual violence. How do we end sexual violence? Too often, the church has dealt with violence against women by minimizing, trivializing, making it invisible, or externalizing it. You will discover that it is a laughing matter. You will discover, even men are violated. Sexual violence is not a woman's issue or a concern of women. It should not be left to the women's desk of the church. You have a desk that deals with the problem. It is a concern of the whole church, and there is a need to change our theology, the theology of creation and biblical interpretation. Change our theology of leadership. Change the theology of marriage and family life. Change the theology of femininity and masculinity. It is in this context, therefore, that I want to offer that if the church has to deal with sexual violence,
of any form. We need to rethink and rewrite the theology of the image of God. When you heard in the morning the church fathers, the root cause is that they didn't think that women were created in the image and likeness of God. So we need to reread Genesis 1, 26 and 27. God created humankind, not one human being, but the whole human community represents God. Not one human being and also not a group of people, men. God can only be represented by both genders. It is important to rethink and challenge the prevailing image of God, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-male, Father, King, Lord, etc. We understand God's maleness to be metaphoric, but this metaphor often attributes divinity to the male, rendering him supreme over the non-divine female. God is absolute, neither male nor female. It is important to reread and reinterpret scriptures. The church in Africa, praise God, prides itself or prides herself being biblically best. Oh, thank you, Bishop. Biblically best. Founded on biblical principles. When we want to attack the others, we say they are not biblical. But I want to ask my fellow church members in Africa that we reread and reinterpret the scriptures in the light of mutuality and not in support of male dominance in society. The predominance of the epistles over the gospels, which is misused against women, should be corrected, and the liberating message of the gospel should take priority. It's very good to be quoting Paul. Paul said, our brother, Paul. He is my brother too, but I don't agree with some of the things that he said, and especially when they are misinterpreted, taken out of context, or when they are used to silence women instead of raising their voices. Let us rethink, how do we preach about sin and evil and challenge ideas of sin pertaining to women as being unclean, or the concept of purity and pollution, which are culturally instigated and religiously affirmed. Challenge the idea that women being the source of impurities connected to being the source of death, attributing the origin of evil and sin to women. And Mimi Haddad raised that early in the morning. I actually removed the slide. That's why Rush had to remove that slide. That God creates two people, and the fall, you know, should not just be seen as the woman who brought it. Rethink the theology of relationship. This needs to be reviewed in the light of the New Testament, especially the Gospels and the early church witness, being a community of equals. Jesus actually shows violence against women is unacceptable when they bring to him a woman caught in the act, but alone. She's caught in the act, but she's alone. I've never known how you are caught in the act alone. The law, and Jesus shows in that story, the law and its interpretation must not discriminate against women. Both men and women are created in the image of God, and that God blessed them and gave them power to manage the resources of the earth, as we heard in the morning. It is important to stop using the concept of Jesus as victim and sacrifice to reinforce structures of violence and tie the victim to their role as victim. You have to suffer, my sister, as Jesus suffered. Women are told to persevere and endure, to sacrifice for her family. Masi Oduiwe has noted that a sacrifice is that which is freely and consciously made and is noble and lovely, loving and motivated by love and gratitude. Violence against women is none of this. Forgive and forget approach. Apparently, is often wrongly drawn between abused women and the violence against Jesus. This contributes to women's oppression. I'll jump that. Forgiveness comes later and is only possible in a safe environment. It takes a long time and is difficult, and only some form of justice is done. Redefine the theology of marriage. The church is a family. The church is where we teach people how to be married and when to be married. But can we say men and women are partners? But in the context of the church, the language of partnership is used for hierarchical relationship that justify the subordination of one gender to the other. Men are seen as dominant partner, and women are expected to be subordinated to men. Our wedding sermons, you know, I go to many of them, and you hear, this is a rib. If it doesn't fit, squeeze, squeeze until it does what it fits. You are a neck. And so the woman is blamed for every evil that the man does, because the neck, the head cannot move without the neck. Some of those theologies are actually violent, as far as I'm concerned. In the understanding of partnership preached by churches, women are relegated to the role of helpers of men and are expected to be subservient to the desires and demands of men. I love Paul when he says in 1 Corinthians 7, when he talks about marriage and raises the issue of mutuality and equality as part and parcel of a healthy sexual relation. So the church should deal with the issue of human sexuality, otherwise it supports violence in our societies. We should look at new models of what is female and male, new masculinities and new femininities. All people are part of a system that molds and conditions them and demands certain roles and behavior that are prescribed as norms by religion, culture, tradition, and patriarchy. Violence against women and churches to stop. Men and women must work together. So men are needed to stand in solidarity with women. Men claim they are as much victims of the patriarchal system as women. Men should be confronted by issues related to male violence and male sexuality, how they benefit from patriarchal power, including theological teachings and practices of the church, searching for new liberative masculinities, what it means to be male in society today. I was going to talk about practical aspects, how churches can deal adequately with people who are being violated, offer shelter to the victims, counsel the victim spiritually, psychologically, legally, and economically. Develop clear policies that protect the victim, legal proceedings against the perpetrators. Take disciplinary action in church against the perpetrator. A woman has come and said, I'm being raped, I'm being violated. We don't say, sister, let us pray for him, he'll be better. He won't be better by prayers. I believe in miracles, but there are some that don't take place. Take legal action. Let the perpetrator know that this is true. Let us express public statement that all forms of violence are a sin that disregards the image of God. Violence should never be tolerated or excused, whether it is violence against women, violence against men. Inform our congregations about the reality of various forms of violence against women in church and society. It doesn't happen out there, it happens actually inside. Make the church a safe place to which victims of violence can turn for safety, support, and healing. My grandmother used to tell me that if you are ever in a place and it is dark and you are late to reach home, look for a church. Look for a pastor. If she woke up today, she will tell me, if it is dark, run away from the pastor, run away from the church. Why? Because we have known that there are people who have been pastors and they've been reined in court for sexual violence. So it is no longer a safe place. But what I'm saying here, let us make the church a safe place to which victims of violence can turn for safety, support, and healing. include issues of violence against women in sermons, catechetical instructions, before baptism and weddings, and in theological curriculum. And I want to pride ourselves that in St. Paul's for the last 10 years, we have talked about violence, we have talked about gender inequality, that whoever lives here, although they may not practice it, in their heart, they know they have been taught. Let us work together with local government bodies and build networks to combat sexual violence. Empower women to take power and to use it. Look how local cultures, imposed cultures, and biblical cultures and interpretation of the Bible have perpetuated violence against women and children. Let women study theology, promote education for women and equal job opportunities in the church. St. Paul's, for the last 10 years, has worked hard to increase the number of women studying theology. Because you cannot say we are equal if the numbers are skewed the other way around. You need the women on the same table. The sad thing is, the churches still practice discrimination when appointing women to the positions of authority within the churches. I hope that is a sin we can repent. Let us hold Bible studies, especially on the text of terror, like the one we read this morning, the story of Tamar. Read the texts which tell us about strong women, as we heard from Honorable Ngilu, texts about women with Jesus. Discuss cultural violence against women, all sorts. Establish a family of congregational mediation group comprised of women and men to settle family disputes. More often, the woman comes, she's being tried on something, and the committee is composed of only men. Surely that is not the image of God, that's not the image of the church, and especially the church where women are many. Surely the committees that try them should have more of them. Let me stop here in case I am harassed more. That was the last one. Thank you very much for listening to me.